I start recording.
Oui.
Okay, so welcome everybody to this second webinar. And today we have the pleasure of hearing a talk by Dr. Ricardo Bruna about source reconstruction in EEG and MEG. And Ricardo studied telecommunications engineering in Universidad of Valladolid. And then he moved to Madrid, where he worked first with Fernando Maestu and Ernesto Pereda, and he did his PhD in biomedical engineering in 2019. Ricardo's work has concentrated both in method development and in analysis of MEG and EEG signals, and he has already collaborated quite extensively with research groups all around the world. And at the moment, he shares his time between the postdoctoral position in Madrid and with a fellowship in Universidad de La Laguna in the Canary Islands. So as a Finn, I'm really envious of that kind of location of positions. So please welcome, and we look forward to your talk.
Thank you very much. Well, you are welcome to Canary Islands when I am there. I am in the north now in León. It is not as cold as Helsinki, but it is not so nice as Canary Islands. So, okay, so let's see. I am going to talk to you about source reconstruction in EEG and MEG. I want to keep it quite quick. You will have all the slides after. I have a PDF. And I have a couple of formulas, but it is not important. You don't need to pay attention to formulas. In fact, I only put as minimum amount of formulas as possible, but I wanted you to know what I am talking about. So let's start with it here. So the reconstruction is the estimation of what is happening in the brain from the measurements we take from the signal, from the sensors. So you have the neural activity, that is the source space signal, the real activity that is happening in the brain, and then you have the measurements, the sensor space signal. Problem is, source reconstruction is an inverse problem. It is, the inverse problems are a group of problems where you have the measurements from an indirect measurement, because even if we are looking at a let's say, direct measurement of the activity in the brain, we are looking at secondary currents, at secondary events. The magnetic field is secondary to the intracellular current that is the real activity in the brain. So we have to infer what is happening from not so good measurements. So we have to estimate the cause from the results. The results are the signals we measure, the sensor signal, and the cause is the activity we want to estimate, the brain activity. So for be able to get a source reconstruction, any inverse model, you need to first create a forward model and see how any activity could cause any cause, any result. Sorry, any cause could create any result. And then you have to make an estimate of how an activity could cause the result you see in your measurement. So it is not so easy to do, but there are some algebraic solutions that can allow for it quite easily. And a good example is the estimation of the composition of the Earth using measurements of the gravity, the gravitational field in the Earth, because the higher the density of the soil behind you, the stronger the gravitational field. So you can see how the Earth below your feet is made of if you measure in different places the gravitational field. So as you can imagine, that is not so easy, but there are some good ways to get a reasonable estimate. So I am going to talk first about the forward model and then about the inverse model, the inverse solution. So you need three things to create a good forward model. First is how you need to see how the signal is generated. This is the source model. Then you have to see how this signal propagates through the space, the conduction model, and then you have to see how the sensors capture this signal. So as Mia said last week, for source model, we use the dipole model. It is exactly, this is the same thing she said, and she said it very well, so I am not going to go deep inside of it. So the idea is that we have a dipolar current that is a single current going from one point to the other. That is the intracellular current, and then we have a secondary current, that is the feedback current in the brain that propagates to the brain. When we measure EEG, we only measure the secondary currents because we cannot measure the inside of the cell. When we measure MEG, we measure both of them because we can see the magnetic field created by both the intracellular and extracellular currents. We can place the sources in different ways. I usually use volumetric sources, so I create a 3D grid inside the skull, in the brain cavity, we call it. You can also use the second one, is the one that is used in Loretta software. It's volumetric sources also, but only in gray matter areas, because only gray matter can generate EEG and MEG signal. And then you have realistic sources that are sources placed only in the exact positions that we are supposed to have this kind of signal. This is in the gray matter and only perpendicular to the surface of the brain. So now for the really interesting thing, the conduction model. The problem is that the head is complex, has a lot of tissues. These tissues have different electrical properties. Luckily, they all have the same magnetic properties, unless you have a metallic plate, for example, in the skull or something like that. So you have to reconstruct how the current is propagating through the different tissues of the head to get from the signals from the neurons to the sensors. And then you have to look at how these current create magnetic fields so you can see how the magnetic signal is generated. The simplest head model is a dipole in the vacuum. So you have a current that is going from one point to the other, and the dipole is a very small dipole. It's an elementary dipole. So it is a very small current, and that is happening in the vacuum. So there is no secondary current. There is no EEG signal. So it is not good for EEG signal, and it is not realistic for MEG signal either. But we can use it, for example, for locating the position of the head using the coils, because the coils are coils that generate a magnetic field, but not a secondary current. So they are used for this only. It is not a good model for the head, but then, and the name is magnetic dipole, because you only generate magnetic fields. But then you have a more realistic, but still not realistic at all, model that is an infinite conducting medium, sorry, with constant conductivity, and a magnet, an electric current, a dipole that is there, and a second set of secondary currents that go through all the space, because as the medium is infinite, and the currents propagate through all the space, like in the space when you have the gravity of a star, you can see the gravity from very far, far away, even if it is very dim. The good thing with this method is that we can simulate both EEG and MEG signals. You can see the potential in any point of the space, because this is an infinite space. And you can see also the magnetic field in any point of the space. And it is integrated both from the primary and secondary currents. So it is a very nice model. The problem is that it is not realistic, because the head is not infinite. So we go to a little more complex model that is a sphere filled with a conductive medium, but surrounded by the vacuum. It is still not so realistic, but not so bad either. Then you can write the same equation we had before in spherical coordinates. Don't pay attention to this equation, because it's a pain in the ass equation. You have the Lagrange polynomials to do the transformation to spherical coordinates, and it is very, very... I had nightmares where I was programming this. But the thing is that then you have to impose a set of boundary conditions. It is very easy to imagine the boundary conditions in this model. You have a sphere. It is filled with a conducting medium, so the currents can move freely in the medium. But then when the current gets to the boundary of the medium, they have to be reflected, because in the outside of the sphere, there is only vacuum, and nothing can, no electrical field can propagate, nor current, sorry, because electrical field can propagate in the vacuum. So you have to model both the primary current that is generating the secondary current, and then these virtual currents that are the reflections of the signal in the surface. But you can do that. It is not so difficult. Sarvas did it in 87, I think it was. They have a very nice paper. The FIN have a lot of papers in this kind of things. So you can look at those papers, and they are very, very good. And it is quite easy to see how this is happening. Both Sarbas made it for MEG and Gieselowicz made it in the 50s, 60s, I don't remember, for EEG. So it is quite easy to do this, but the good thing is that the current distribution is very easy to model, so you can solve this analytically. The idea when you solve something analytically is that you have an exact result. The problem is that your model is not exact, so it is not so good, and it is very easy to calculate, so it is very doable computationally. The problem, about the what we do, the sensors are placed on the boundary, and the mesh sensors are placed in the outside of the conductor. If you remember, there is Mia talked about the spheres and the royal correction, so because this model is still used for MEG because it is very interesting in some ways. First, because the mesh signal is independent of the conductivity, it's only dependent on the geometry of the head. So this model can be very useful for MEG. The problem is that MEG is insensitive to radial sources because, as Mia said last week, and she did a very good job, the secondary magnetic field exactly cancels out the primary magnetic field. So the current and the magnetic field that is generated by the neuron itself is nullified, it's canceled out by the secondary currents, the magnetic field generated by the secondary currents when the source is radial because of symmetry, as both sides of the dipole have exactly the same distribution, because if you are in a radial position in a sphere, you can look left or right and you are seeing exactly the same. So there is this magic, this mathematical magic that makes that the MEG signal is canceled. This only happens in spherical mediums, but not really. So it is as easy as this. If you have a magnetic radial current in a spherical field and a spherical conductor, but you can have something similar to this in an arbitrary conductor. So it is something very important to take in account. The model is too simple for EEG. That is the main problem, because the tissues in the heads have different conductivities. Especially the skull has a much lower conductivity than the rest of the tissues, more or less like 80 times lower conductivity than the soft tissues in the brain. So this is not a good model for EEG. But it can be adequate for MEG because if the current, as the skull is so low conductivity, most of the currents, about 95% of the current, is confined inside of the cranium. So if you can model the inside of the cranium with an sphere, it is a not so bad model. And it is quite used today. But it is insensitive to radial sources. So, how you solve the problem with the EEG? Then you write something similar, but instead of using a sphere in the vacuum, use several spheres, concentric spheres that have different conductivity and are surrounded by the vacuum. And this is more realistic for the head, and it is quite used still today. It was very used in the 90s because it is a very easy model, and the computers were not so good, but it is still used today. Usually the model has three layers. The inner sphere is a high conductivity sphere that has the brain, the white and gray matter, and the cerebrospinal fluid. Then you have a medium sphere with very low conductivity, and this is the skull, the bone. And then you have the outer sphere where the electrodes are placed, that is the scalp, and has, again, high conductivity. You can add a fourth layer between the brain and the skull. This will be the second layer, with very high conductivity cerebrospinal fluid, and that improves the measurement, but it is not so easy because the model, all the models, all the surfaces in the three layer are more or less spherical. The head is not a sphere, but the model is more or less adequate if the head is a normal head. You have the brain cavity that is not a sphere, but more or less a sphere, especially in the top, because it is flat in the bottom because the brain is laying in the base of the cranium, but the upper part of the head is quite spherical. So it is not so bad, and the electrodes are there. So it is not so bad, as I said. Then you have the outer part of the skull that is more or less parallel to this one. So it can also be modeled more or less with a sphere. And then you have the outer part of the head, the scalp, that can also be modeled with some error as an sphere. But the cerebrospinal fluid is very intricated because it follows the what's the name for it, the circumvolutions in the brain. So it is difficult to model it as an sphere. So you can improve your estimation if you add this layer, but this layer has a lot of intrinsic errors. It is still better than not taking it in account, but it is not as good as could be. The good thing here is that the solution for MEG is exactly the same to that of a single sphere, because as I said before, the only thing that is important in MEG is the geometry, how the current is oriented respect to the surface of the sphere, and the conductivity is not important. And the only difference between one sphere and several spheres is that these several spheres have different conductivity. As MEG signal is blind to this conductivity, and there is no difference. So you can use exactly the same definition for one layer or three layers or four layers for the MEG. And that is very good, because that allows us to still use MEG, not exactly the spherical solution for MEG, but something similar to spherical solution. For example, there is a solution that is called local spheres, where you model the head as a sphere, but the sphere is different for every sensor. If you have a sensor here in the top, you have a sphere that it fits the scalp in the closest part to the sensor. Then you have here a sensor. It is a much larger sphere because it has to fit this part of the head, but it works. And it works very well, and it is easy, still use it today. It is, I think, the default solution in Brainstorm, and it's one of the most broadly used methods, softwares in MEG analysis. In MNE, they usually use VEM because Matti Hämäläinen, when created the original MNE, focused on VEM a lot, but they also have the solution. And then there is this the Noltes solution, the modified spherical solution, that it models the head as a sphere, and that modifies slightly the solution to make it more realistic, to fit better the real shape of the head. But these are analytical solutions, are not exact because the head is not exactly modeled, but and they are very fast to compute. Maybe the local spheres is extremely quick. The modified spherical solution is not as quick, but maybe we're talking about 2 seconds for a participant, so it is almost instantaneous. And these are based in very basic mathematics developed in the 80s, because nobody looked at this before the 80s, but the bases are from the 50s, 60s. The problem is that if you want a more complex geometry, you need to use a numerical approach. The first one is the boundary element method. When you can define several, like before, you define several surfaces that don't need to be spheres because you are solving it numerically, no analytically, so you don't need any fixed geometry, but you still need that the surfaces, at least in the original definition, you need that the surfaces are nested. The inner one is inside, completely inside the second one, and they don't have intersections. And then there is the third one that is outside the second one with no intersections and so on. Now they have some modifications in these methods that allow non-nested geometries, but I have not used them, so I don't know how good they are. But with the VEM methods, you can more or less follow the surfaces, the main surfaces at least on the head. And the solution only depends, as in the other case, on the boundary conditions. This is the surfaces themselves. In the other case, it was the same, but as it was a sphere, it was quite easy to solve it analytically. Here, we have to solve it numerically. You put a set of triangles, of nodes, and vertex joining them. In the 89, Hämäläinen and Sarvas made this model in the left. It was a very simple model because the computer was not so good. But right now, for example, I am using the model in the right, and that has three layers, the inner of the skull, the outer part of the skull, and the scalp. And you can place the sources in any place inside this volume. You can place the electrodes in any place outside this volume, and you can get a very good estimation of how the current is flowing from the sources to the sensors. In some cases, you have more complex geometries. For example, if you cannot model your surfaces as nested, for example, if you have a surgical case of epilepsy, when you drill holes in the skull, you don't have a complete surface, a closed surface defining your skull. So you have to use another approaches. For that, you can use finite element methods. It's very similar to that, but instead of having three big conductors, you have a lot of small conductors. And these small conductors are the finite element. Each element can have different conductivity, and each element has its own boundary condition. So it is more complex. You have more relations between different elements. It has some computational advantages, but it is in general more complex computationally than the BEM models. But it is doable, and I have used it, and it is not so when you don't have a lot of information. If your head is more or less okay, you have the inner part of the skull, the outer part of the skull, and the scalp. The BEM models and the FEM models give almost the same results, so it is easier to go with the BEM models. But if you have complex geometries, you can use this one. And these are examples of FEM head models. In the left one, you have each pixel in the image, a voxel in the real image, but a pixel here is an element with different conductivity properties. And in the right, you have a 3D model showing exactly the same, the brain of a participant. I think that is only the inner part of the skull and the outer part of the skull. There is no scalp here. There is no soft tissue surrounding the skull in this image, but it was modeled for the computation. And I said before that the MEG signal is, the MEG is blind to radial sources when you have an spherical conductor, but in any case, you have a conductor, a set of conductors, you will always have some orientation in your sources that is more or less symmetrical. And the distribution of currents, of secondary currents generated by these primary sources, source, this primary current, is going to be symmetrical, so the secondary magnetic field is going to cancel the primary magnetic field. This is a simulation I made. In the top row, you have the orientation of the sources. If you suppose you have perpendicular orientations to the surface of the gray matter, that as the model says that the signal is generated by the apical dendrite in the gray matter, the current must be perpendicular to the surface of the gray matter. So this is the orientation of the current. It is in RGB. R is X, that is right, positive to the right. Y is anterior, positive to the front. And Z is superior, positive to the top. And you have the blind orientation in the second row. So you can see that all the parts that are in red are blind to the right-left axis. So if you have a completely right current there, your mesh system is not going to be able to measure it because it is pseudo-radial, let's say. So the secondary currents are going to cancel the magnetic field generated by the primary current. Fortunately, that is not a lot. In the bottom row, you have the sensitivity of MEG to the realistic sources placed in every part of the brain. You can see that just in the very top of the gyri, you have some blindness, but in the rest of the brain, you can see at least some of the information. More, I think the simulation said that 90% of the sources are seen with at least 50% sensitivity. So this is not as bad as one could imagine, because you said you have three orientations, the male is blind to one of the orientations, so you are losing 33% of the information. That is not right. You are losing some information, but it's a very small amount. So the third thing you have for the forward model is the sensor model. We usually model the sensors as a single point, point-like sensors. That is not so good because the EEG sensors are not exactly a point. You have a lot of gel, and this gel is conductive, so you have several parts, let's say a big dot with the same electrical properties, the same potential, because they are short circuit. And the MEG sensors have a non-infinitesimal area either. So the magnetic field is not the same across the sensors. They are not short circuit. So you can model the magnetic sensors as a set of points instead of a point. For example, Merin in their moment Electa uses this definition for the magnetic sensors they have in the Neuromag machine. They have 9 points for the magnetometers and 8 points for the planar radiometers. And they have here the position of the different points, the integration points, they call it. It is Gauss integration, and the weight of these points. So you, instead of having only 1 point for per magnetic sensor, you have 8 points for a magnetometer, for a radiometer, and 9 points for a magnetometer. And that gives you a better estimate of what is measuring the sensor. So the better your estimate of what the sensor is measuring, the better your source reconstruction is going to be, because your inverse model is going to depend in your forward model. Here you have an example of an EEG and MEG sensor placing. You can see that the MEG sensors are not point-like, but the EEG sensors are. And here you have the result. A FEM model in the left, a FEM model in the middle, and a modified spherical solution. This will be the modified spherical solution in the far right. You only need to use, as I said before, one layer for the MEG, because most of the current is concentrated inside of the scale. So it is a not so bad solution, and it is very fast to calculate. And here you have in the left, you have another complete model with the sources are, I don't know if you can see it, but very small brown dots inside of the brain. Then you have the three layers, and then you have the sensors, the AEG sensors in this case, as crosses, red crosses. And you have an example from Walters. Walters is one of the guys that is writing the book in FEM right now. He made this simulation of the electric potential or the electric current that could be generated by a thalamic source. You can see the arrow, the green arrow is the source, and how this generates different potentials and different currents across all the head. You have to take all this conductivity in account to get a good forward model. And you need a good forward model to create the lead field, the mathematical definition of how a source is causing the origin is causing the measurement, because you need to invert this process. You need the forward model, solve the forward model, to be able to solve the inverse model, that is, at least at the end of the day, an inversion of this problem. So at the end, you have a linear model saying that your sensor activity is an operator multiplied by your source activity. And the good thing with this is that you can use the superposition principle, so you can separately calculate the lead field for each one of the sources you have in your model, and then you know that if you have two sources activated at the same time, the activity that you are going to measure is the sum of the two activities that you will measure if the different sources were activated separately. It's a linear superposition. It is very simple, but that allows us to create this very nice formula saying that the only relation between the sources and the sensors is a linear matrix. And the thing is that now you have to invert this linear matrix. So you have these inverse models that are just the inversion of the linear matrix that is defining the lead field. The problem is that the source reconstruction is an ill-posed problem. You have one measurement, and this measurement can be created by a lot of source superpositions. You don't have one unique solution to your inverse problem. You have a lot of them, so you have to choose which solution is the best for you. So for doing that, we impose some restrictions, so you can get a single solution, because the measurement gives us a lot of solutions, but only one of the solutions is going to be agreeing with also with the restriction we are going to impose. So you put a lot of a priori assumptions, and depending on these assumptions, you have different inverse solvers. The simple solution is the single dipole. The single dipole bases on the idea that your measurement, all the measurement, is coming from only one point in the brain. So you have one source that is placed somewhere, you don't know where, in the brain, with some orientation, you don't know the orientation either, and with some amplitude, you don't know the amplitude either. But you only have one source of activity. That is why it is called single dipole. It's a point-like source explaining all the activity. And it is very easy to check if this is a little bit of the informatics talk about the MP and P, the polynomial problems and the non-polynomial problems. This is a non-polynomial problem. It is very easy to check if the solution is correct but it is not so easy to find the correct solution. So the good thing is that you can check if the solution fit, and what you do is to use, I think it is in the next one, yeah, here. When you do is using an iterative search, that is why this method is sometimes called dipole fitting. You have to fit the dipole someplace in some place in the head. So you follow an iterative way to look at the solution in one position, see how good your solution is. Then you move slightly the dipole, check again how good the solution is, and you move the dipole until you get a minimum in the error. The error is measured with the goodness of fit. Sorry, the formula should appear now, not before, sorry. The goodness of fit is a measurement of how good your solution is. So you minimize the goodness of the error or maximize the goodness of fit. If your fitness is correct, then you have a goodness of fit of one. You don't have an error. So all your measurement is coming from only one source, and the source is exactly in the exact place you are looking at. That is not usually the case in MEG because, as you can imagine, the brain is complex and has a lot of things going inside, but it is still good in some cases. So the problem with this method is that it is based in an iterative search, a nonlinear search, and it is sometimes it never gets to a minimum. Sometimes it gets to a fake minimum, a relative minimum instead of the absolute minimum. So sometimes the solution is not so good, but when it works very well. For example, the solution can be used when you have the brain mapping of very basic physiological activity, for example, the auditory response, the visual response, sensory motor activity. If you have the stimulation of the median nerve in the arm, this activity maps exactly to the motor area, exactly to the area that is in charge of moving of innervating this nerve and moving the, I think it is the middle finger. So it is a very point-like activity that you can force. So it is very easy to get a good reconstruction of this. It is also used in language because, as you know, the language is more or less, it is not exactly a point, but the language in the brain is located in a very definitive area. So if you have, for example, a tumor that is affecting part of your left frontal brain, you have to remove this tumor so you can try to save the most of the language area so the patient doesn't need to will not have problems to communicate after the surgery. So the idea is to map the activity in the motor area in terms of language, the language area, Broca's area. So the surgeon knows that it is better not to touch this. So it is it is usually called brain mapping. So it works very well for this, and it also works very well for the location of epileptogenic areas in the brain, because if you have an epileptogenic area, it is an area, a very small area, usually in the brain that is generating a strange activity, usually a little jump of activity and overactivation. So you can average these spikes, and you can see where the average spike is with this method. And in fact, the dipole fitting is the only method that it is currently considered good enough for clinical use. So if you want to remove a part of the brain, if you need to remove, because you don't usually want to remove, but if you need to remove a part of the brain because of epilepsy, the only thing you can base your detection in, at least you should base your location of this epileptogenic point in, is the dipole fitting of the activity. And this is an example of a measurement of the magnetic M100 visual response. You have the measurement in the left, and you have the simulation of the dipole. You can see the dipole in the right, in the rotating head. And you can see that it is quite likely that this activity is being generated there. You have a goodness of fit of 98%. So it is a not so bad, it could be better, but it is a not so bad fit. So you can map in quite well where this activity is being generated and where the visual response is being generated. The problem is that Here, one simple dipole is not going to fit very well the activity because you have a bi-hemispherical brain, so you have activity in both hemispheres, and the visual activity is mapped from to both hemispheres. In this case, the activation was in the middle of the screen, so both hemispheres are going to have activation, so you need at least two dipoles to be able to explain this activity. So you have to extend this solution. You have the ability to use, instead of one, multiple dipoles. The problem is that this method is also iterative and has three variables, the position variables per dipole. So when you have a lot of dipoles, it is a very slow process because you have to move every one of the dipoles independently on the other one, so you can fit one of the dipoles, but when you move other one, the fit is going to go bad, so you need to move again the first one. So it is not very easy. You can force symmetry. For example, in the case I was talking about, the visual areas are supposed to be more or less symmetrical, so you can force that both dipoles are more or less in the same position but in different hemispheres. It also works very well for auditory response because it is bilateral, and it is a way to reduce the dimensionality of this problem, but still it is not so good because you need to create this nonlinear iterative search that might not converge. So there is an extension of this idea that is the distributed source model. In the distributed source model, you have sources distributed across the head, but with fixed positions. You know where the possible sources are. That doesn't mean that all the sources will have an activity, but all the sources can have an activity. So you are restricting the activity instead of saying, okay, it is, so the activity is coming from somewhere inside of the head, so I am going to look at all the possible positions. Here you say, no, I have one source that is here, and the other source is going to be 1 millimeter apart from this, and then you are covering all the head with sources. That is, and those are the source models I showed you before. And then we can solve this analytically using the minimum norm solution. So minimum norm is the main method to solve the distributed source model for inverse reconstruction. And it is also very easy to do. You only have to calculate the inverse of the lead field. The lead field is not a square matrix because you usually have a lot of sources and not so many sensors. You have to use the pseudo inverse, but it is good. And it gives you one single solution, that it is the solution with the measurement, the solution that explains the measurement with the minimum amount of source energy. All the lead field is inverted at one, so the result is going to depend on the number of sources, and all the measurement is going to be explained by these sources. For example, if you have a noise, this noise is going to be explained by your sources. If you have an artifact, for example, a blink, this blink is going to be explained by your sources, probably the frontal ones, because and those are the closest to the eyes. So the good thing is the activity is invertible because all your activity is going to be explained by the source, but it is also bad because you are also explaining the noises, but it is usually not a very good problem. And if your data is clean enough, this is a good solution. The problem is that it is biased because as it looks for the minimum power, the minimum source space power, the closest the source is to the sensor, the lower the power in the source needs to be to get the same activation in the sensor. If the activity is twice the distance, the power of the activation needs to be four times because it increases with the square of the distance, four times as powerful, so it is easier to explain the activity with superficial sources. And that is what I said here. but there are some approaches that can address this problem, and the main ones are DSPM and Loretta. DSPM uses a very smart idea. It normalizes the solution by the noise, usually the baseline activity. So it can only be used for task-related activity, but the idea is that this bias is going to be the same for the signal and the noise. So your baseline is going to be overestimated in the superficial sources and underestimated in the deep sources. So if you correct your activation amplitude by the baseline activity, you can get a bias-free measurement. It is a way of normalizing the output. The shape of the wave is what it is important and not the amplitude itself. And here is an example of some simulated sources, in this case, reconstructed with the original minimum norm in the right, and in the left, sorry, and the DSPN, the noise normalized reconstruction, in the right. You can see that when the source is deep, it is explained by a lot of superficial sources, but if you use this correction, you can quite well locate the activity. In the third row, you can see that when the source of activation is superficial, it is not so big of a problem because the activity is going to be very well located, but in the cases when the activation is deep, you are going to explain this activation with superficial sources that will give you an error in your reconstruction. The second idea to solve this is Loretta. Loretta uses lead field normalization. Instead of normalizing the solution, normalizes the forward model. The thing with this minimum norm solution is that as the more superficial sources have an associated lead field that has a smaller amplitude, the inversion of this lead field gives higher values because when you invert something, it is like a division. So the smaller the number, the inversion gives you a larger number. So it is biased toward the smaller lead fields. If you normalize the lead fields, all the lead fields have the same amplitude. So when you invert them, there is no bias anymore. So it penalizes the superficial solution, or if you want to see it the other way around, it artificially increases the likelihood of the deep sources or the cost of the superficial ones. In addition to this, it forces that there is a relation between the activity of neighboring sources. It is a low resolution solution. The name of Loretta is low resolution electrical tomography because it forces that if you have an activation in one source, the neighboring sources are going to have a similar activation because it doesn't make sense that you have a very small area of the brain activated and the surrounding area are not activated because we know that EEG and MEG has low resolution. So your solution also needs to be low resolution. The problem is that the original method is outdated, but they have now S-Loretta and E-Loretta that are quite similar, both of them, and are also standardized and normalized and have very good results for EEG. And then you have the third method, or the second one, if you look only to the realistic ones, not the dipole fitting ones, is dipole scanning. Dipole scanning bases in the idea that its position is a dipole and you can reconstruct the activity on this dipole alone without taking in consideration the rest. Its reconstruction is independent. You reconstruct every one of the sources independently of the rest of them, and it is based on special filters. So you have a lot of sensors, and you can use them to focus like a lens in a spatial point. As you have sensors in a 3D space, you can locate exactly one point and you can focus your sensitivity in only one point. That point is the source reconstruction, the source position you are going to reconstruct. The method comes from the idea of radar. So it is usually named beamforming because it is a beam conformation. You use a lot of antenna each antenna has a sensitivity profile, and you can use a lot of antenna to modify this profile. So you can form the beam of your antenna, both for emitting and receiving. In this case, we are only receiving, but you can also use this technique to create a beam, a special beam to transmit some signal only to a point. So it is named beamforming. It was developed in the 80s, I think in the 70s, 80s, and it was applied to the MEG in the 90s. And the more extended method is the linearly constrained minimum variance beamformer. It is also a spatial filter, but the problem with a spatial filter is that it is not imperfect. It is not perfect. It is a lens, but this lens has artifacts. So if you have a very strong interference, you can have this going through the lens. For example, if you have a glare if you are wearing glasses and you look at a point and you have a very strong source of light in your side, you can have a glare lens. So you can see a very bright spot in your field of view, even if it is not in the part of the field that you are looking at and that should be focused. What linear LCMV, linear constraint minimum variance does, is to remove this interference looking for them. First looks for the interference and then it removes it. So it creates a set of secondary spatial filters that look only for the interference and then subtract this reconstruction from the reconstructed signal. The problem is that it is based in correlations. If your interference cannot be correlated with what you are looking at, so it removes what it is not correlated, but if your interference is correlated with your what you are seeing, then it can destroy the thing you are seeing, because when trying to remove the interference is also removing the activity of interest. So it has some problems with highly correlated signals. It is not usually the case in MEG because you in MEG or EEG in brain activity, because different parts of the brain do different things. But it can be, for example, problematic when you use auditory responses, because both auditory fields are activities at the same time and with very similar activities. So they are very correlated, and it can be difficult to locate the activity in auditory responses using beamformer or not. In fact, there are several papers saying that it is not so bad, but it might be a problem. The idea is that you have, this is an example of a one-dimensional beamformer, because it is very difficult to see it in 3D. You have the filter center here. I don't know if you can see. Yeah, you can see the arrow. Here is the direction you are looking at. So you have this red activity you are looking at, but you also have this yellow activity that is an interference. As the response of your filter is not zero in this direction, you are going to have a very small interference. The problem is that if your activity is the small one and the interference is very big, you have the same amplitude for both the activity of interest and interference, and you cannot tell them apart because this output is integrated. You are seeing all of this at the same time. What LCMV does is putting a zero, a null, in the direction of the interference, so it cancels this interference. The thing, the problem and the good thing, and both of them, is that when you need to remove an activity, you need to identify the activity. That is why it is called an adaptive filter. It adapts the response to the interferences. So you have to look for the interference and then you have to remove it. And it works quite well for removing interferences. And this is good because you are reconstructing only the activity in one point of the brain without taking a look at the rest of the activity. So you are not reconstructing noises that don't come from this part of the brain, for example, external noises, artifacts, or so. So that is very good. But the problem is that it has other limitations. For example, here you can see that you have several points where the response is zero. You can only have as many points where the response is zero. Usually you can say that if you have 100 sensors, you have 99 points where your sensitivity is zero. And if you reject interferences, you are modifying the position of these points. So you can only reject a limited number of interferences depending on the number of sensors you have. But it works. And as an overview, you have that the forward models for EEG require 3 or 4 layers. You cannot use only one layer, so the original spherical solution is not valid for EEG, but you can use very simple models like the several layers spherical solution for EEG. The spherical models are computationally simple, but they are also very simplified. So you need to take in account a lot of things. For example, the head is not a complete sphere, the thickness of the skull is not homogeneous, so if you are using a spherical solution to solve the EEG problem, you can do it, the solution is going to be valid, but it will have some problems, so you have to take that in account. And nowadays, it is quite easy to get a very good BEM solution with maybe in 5-10 minutes per participant, so you can use it for some things, but sometimes you need to, if you need to do something very quick or you need to do a lot of testings or something like that, you can use a spherical solution. And then after you get the spherical solution, refine it with a BEM model. And the models are quite precise, but they have some limitations. As I said before, they only work well when you have nested surfaces and so. For regarding the inverse models, the original definition of Loretta is updated, but it is not a problem because Pascual Marchi developed E-Loretta and S-Loretta that are state of the art and they work very well. The minimum null solutions, all of them give very similar results. I have a slide later showing it. And the beamformer is not adequate in theory for EEG because the beamformer solution is exact. That doesn't mean that the solution is going to be exact, but it is based on the idea that your measurement is going to be exact and your lead field is going to be exact. And when you use EEG, the lead field is by definition imperfect because you cannot map all the current conductivities in all the head, so you will have some errors. Beamformer is exact, so it can give you some problems. Minimum norm allows for errors. In fact, one of the things that minimum norm minimizes, in addition to the solution itself, is the error. It looks the solution with the minimum activity, but also the minimum error. So it allows for some error. So if your lead is imperfect, it will work better. And here we have an example of source reconstruction. It is a normalized source reconstruction because I use it the location of the alpha peak using the relative alpha power. This is the alpha power between 8 and 12 hertz divided by the total high broadband power. So it is normalized because this estimation is going to be both for the alpha band and the rest of the spectrum. It's going to be biased toward superficial sources in M&E, and it is also biased towards deep sources in LC-MVA. In informer, I didn't say that, but it's also biased especially. But in this case, it is not important because we are looking at the shape of the signal, not at the amplitude of the signal. And you can see that the minimum norm estimation is very similar to the S-Loretta estimation and very similar to the E-Loretta estimation. And it is different from the beamformer estimation because those are completely different approaches, but these three approaches are very, very similar. And that is all. I don't know.